Good evening, everyone. I am Mark Strickland, the provost here of the beautiful Seminole campus. And kind of off script, I'd like to welcome the former provost, and he's enjoying the good life. Dr. Jim Oliver is the former provost here at the Seminole campus. He's here with us as well. Nice to see you, Dr. Oliver. I'd also like to start the evening by recognizing our co-sponsors for the evening, the Tampa Bay Times and WEDU Television. Thank you very much. And while I'm giving thanks, I'd also like to thank our faculty members who have allowed for some of our students to participate in this evening's event. Where are the students here this evening? Where are you guys at? It's nice to see students participating in the program as well. So this marks the second program of our 2016-17 dinner series, formerly known as Village Square, and it's presented to you by our Institute for Strategic Policy Solutions. We present these forums as a way to support our concept that good food and good conversation go hand in hand. And so our goal here is to take the major issues of the day, discuss them in a civil way, and to see if we can arrive at a consensus on some points, or at least promote an understanding of each other's views. So I hope you enjoy the program. I hope you enjoyed your dinner as well. Now I'd like to turn the program over to David Clement, who's our executive director of the Institute.
Thank you, Provost Strickland. And good evening to all of you. Please continue enjoying your dinner while we begin the program. And also, I want to say a little bit of intro about our topic. Jonathan, can we have the first instant polling question posted one more time for those who came in late or had a little trouble voting? And if there's a student nearby, ask the student to help, because we hear that young people are always supposed to be so good with digital devices. Just remember, you can only vote once, and you vote by texting the word SPC Seminole, all one word, to the number 22333. And then you should get this screen, and you can vote by typing the letter A if you agree, B if you disagree, and C if you can't decide yet. So I'll just wait enough, maybe 30 seconds, give everybody a chance to get into the survey. It looks like, so far, most people agree, but maybe a lot of people haven't voted yet. Anyone having a problem that needs help voting? Here's a lady. Is there? You have to have a smartphone with a texting application to participate. I'm sorry. Oh, what is your question?
I don't know what politically correct means, so I can't answer.
You haven't been listening to the political debate for the last 15 months, 18 months. That's all we heard, was that we don't want to be politically correct. That means being shushed or censored for saying something that is on your mind. You must be politically correct, so it goes, by not saying certain things. All right, we will get it. We'll get into that in the discussion. For now, let's close the survey, Jonathan, and let me introduce the topic. As Provost Strickland mentioned, We hold these events to promote civil discourse about the top issues of the day, no matter how controversial. And if you read our news events and event reminders that we send out regularly, you know that we don't shun from getting involved in controversial topics. In the past year or so, we've dealt with the legalization of same-sex marriage, the legalization of medical marijuana, guns, and the like. So it's more than a bit ironic, it seems, that the topic of tonight's program is about the very idea of talking about stuff, that is, sensitive stuff, potentially offensive stuff, and about the freedom to do so. Free speech has been taking hits long before our most recent national election. As you saw in the slideshow, if you noticed it, in my day back in the 60s, it was all about stifling opposition to the Vietnam War and suppressing protests of civil rights, for civil rights. That's when flag burning as a form of protest began, actually. These were really big issues, and political correctness hadn't yet been invented, for the lady who didn't know what it was. Today, it's much broader and more pervasive. Even as we become sensitive to the words we say in public, as our culture has gradually edited out offensive thoughts that once were commonly expressed words, there, madam, is a definition of political correctness. We've gradually edited out offensive thoughts that once were commonly expressed in words. But now there's growing pressure in three directions. One is to ban the very ideas behind speech that someone considers offensive. A second is to punish the public opposition to certain ideas. And a third is to do away with the politically correct practice of shaming overtly offensive speech. That which we have done so out of courteous sensitivity to others' feelings. When we settled on this topic way back in the summer of 2016, before the primary season was over and the party nominees were selected, we had no idea how the events of the day would affect this topic, how it would play into this discussion. But they certainly have, I think you'll all agree. The issue has gotten so much broader than our original version of just addressing the suppression of free speech on college and university campuses. Tonight, we will endeavor to address the academic perspective as well as the new concerns in the political arena about freedom of speech. We've asked our panel to look at it from an academic, a constitutional, and a sociological perspective. And we will bring you, the audience, into the conversation, as we always do, one with the instant polling, and later with questions and answers from you. Let's begin now by meeting our first speaker. It is my pleasure to introduce to you Ms. Susan Kruth, who is Program Officer of the Individual Rights Defense Program at the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education. That is FAIR. FAIR is a nonprofit whose mission is to defend and sustain individual rights at America's colleges and universities, rights which include freedom of speech, legal equality, due process, religious liberty, and sanctity of conscience. Her bio is in your program, so we don't need to recite it here. Let's just meet her right now and give her a warm welcome. Susan Kruth.
Thank you very much, and thank you to SPC for having me here today. There's a lot going on college and university campuses these days. And some of it is exactly what we should be seeing on college campuses, things like political activism, debate, hard-hitting journalism. But at the same time, there are continual threats to freedom of expression, too. And sometimes it can be hard to tell what endangers free speech and what's just another contribution to the marketplace of ideas. So I want to talk about some recent trends on campus and also some overarching points to put those trends in context. First, a quick overview of First Amendment law for any non-lawyers in the audience. Among other things, the First Amendment protects expression from censorship or punishment by the government. And the government in this context also includes public colleges and universities. The vast majority of speech is protected by the First Amendment, and there's only a couple narrowly defined categories of speech that are unprotected. These are categories like true threats, incitement to imminent lawless action, fighting words, obscenity, child pornography, and defamation. And the specific legal definitions might be narrower than the way that we use these words casually. For the most part, offensive speech, hurtful speech, and even hateful speech are protected speech. I work at the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, or FIRE, an organization dedicated to defending free speech and due process on college campuses. And every day we talk to students who really do understand the breadth of the First Amendment and the speech that it protects, and who are determined to fully exercise their rights and to defend the rights of their classmates even when they disagree with them. We also continually work with administrators to improve schools' policies to better protect student and professor rights. So even though we're gonna talk about calls for censorship and threats to free expression on campus, I wanna make clear that these trends they represent a split in the campus community, not just a complete shift in mindset from one to another. In other words, things aren't hopeless, it's just that protecting freedom of expression is really an ongoing process. So what do we have to be concerned about these days? Well, there's a lot of people talking about microaggressions and safe spaces and trigger warnings. But there's also a lot of disagreement as far as what these terms mean and how they should be used to protect the campus community. Take safe spaces. If by safe spaces you mean a time and place where individuals who share a common belief or a common characteristic come together to be comfortable, or maybe to hash out ideas among themselves before they take on the world, well, that's just part of freedom of association. If by safe spaces you mean demanding that entire campuses be sterilized according to the standards of the most sensitive student, making sure that there are no offensive or hurtful things being said, that's not what the university is for. And at public institutions, the First Amendment actually prohibits administrators from creating such an environment through the use of speech codes or threats of punishment. Most private schools also promise their campus communities freedom of expression. So if even a private school tried to create an emotionally safe space at all times, that would probably go against their other policies. Between these two alternatives of a safe space as just a meeting place or as a speech-restrictive campus, there are countless iterations of what someone could call a safe space. But a lot of conversations about safe spaces, and I think most of the conversations that I've seen, are missing this part where we figure out exactly what we're all talking about, what we're referring to. The same is true for trigger warnings. Before they were a topic of campus debate, they became common as sort of a heads up on online message boards and forums when someone was about to talk about something that a reader might find upsetting. And as a courtesy or an option that the speaker can choose to maybe make the audience more receptive to whatever they're saying, that can be a useful tool. But when professors or other speakers are required to put warnings or labels on their speech or on the speech of others that they're about to share, there's ramifications that are worth considering. So for one, the emotional impact, including sometimes a surprise element, is often what makes speech persuasive or effective, however you want to define effective. and deciding how to present classroom materials is part of academic freedom. So we shouldn't punish professors for choosing, for example, to let art or literature simply speak for itself. Besides that, any kind of mandatory labeling or disclaimer really sends a message to the entire campus community that some types of speech are disfavored, and that can chill potentially productive and important discussion. So just like safe spaces, trigger warnings can be implemented in a way that's consistent with free speech principles, but unfortunately, that's not always what those asking for trigger warnings are talking about. Just yesterday, I was talking to a new intern at Fire where I work, a law student who was saying that in his criminal law classes, they're not talking about the law as it relates to rape. And it seems like just a couple months ago, I was reading about law students requesting trigger warnings before these conversations happened, even in the class where it's completely expected. And now these discussions aren't happening at all. And even in elite law schools, this was like a top 10 law school. I think this trend is unacceptable. If we can't discuss rape and rape law with law students, then how are we ever going to deal with rape when it happens? How are we ever going to move those cases through the criminal justice system? I'm going to move on to microaggressions. As a First Amendment advocate, it's not my job, or it's not FIRE's job, to decide whether it's valid for people to feel hurt about certain comments or if they feel they've been treated differently because of their race or sex or any other characteristic. And it's certainly well within any student's rights to urge his or her peers to be more sensitive to what people might be going through. But public colleges and private colleges that promise their students free expression can't punish microaggressions. As I said before, only a few narrow categories of speech are unprotected by the First Amendment. What's most relevant here is the fact that schools can punish and prohibit harassment. And that's conduct that's so severe, pervasive, and objectively offensive that it effectively bars the victim's access to an educational opportunity or benefit. What I just read was the definition for student-on-student harassment set forth by the Supreme Court in the 1999 case, Davis versus Monroe County Board of Education. Now, by definition, microaggressions are small, obviously, micro. Often they're inadvertent, and so the speaker might not realize that they're committing them. And by some definitions that I've seen, even the purported victim might not realize that they're happening. So it's hard to see how they would ever be so severe and objectively offensive that they prevent someone from receiving their education. If remarks or behavior even approach that point, then they wouldn't be microaggressions at all. They would be something else. And certainly a true threat or incitement to imminent lawless action can't be called micro anything. So microaggressions remain protected under the First Amendment. And this is a really good thing, because if students were afraid that the smallest slight would land them in trouble, then they're probably going to choose only to talk to people who they know share their viewpoints and their backgrounds. And that's not what universities are for. For most of us, they're supposed to be places where you can meet people who are different, have different opinions and different backgrounds. So with all this in mind, it's worth keeping an eye on how college administrators and campus communities are using these terms and what policies they're actually advocating for. Of course, when it comes to free speech on campus, there are much older problems than these two. For a decade, FIRE has tracked speech codes at institutions across the country for our Spotlight database. If you're interested, you can go to thefire.org/spotlight. You'll see it. And this year for our annual report, Spotlight on Speech Codes, we surveyed 449 public and private schools. You might have seen the slide up there before about our results. We rated schools as red light, yellow light, green light, or warning schools. So I'm just going to give you a quick overview of what those mean. Green light schools maintain no policies that infringe on constitutionally protected expression. That's our best rating, obviously. Red light schools maintain at least one policy that both clearly and substantially restricts protected expression. And yellow light schools maintain policies that are broad enough or vague enough that they can be abused to punish protected expression. So that sounds not as bad as red light schools, but actually even yellow light policies or policies that FIRE has rated as yellow lights have been struck down in courts and ruled unconstitutional. So they're still bad. Warning schools, there's just a couple of them, but those are schools that openly prioritize other values over freedom of expression. So for a private school, it's their right to do that if they want to. It's their right to say that students don't have freedom of expression as long as they're open about it. Most private schools don't choose to do that. They say to their students and often their professors that they're going to have freedom of expression. And sadly, most private schools also break those promises by also implementing speech codes or rules that restrict expression. So schools' policies have been getting better over the years, but to be honest, they're still pretty awful. Of the 449 institutions that we surveyed, only 27 receive a green light rating. 27 schools, not 27%. And for public schools, a green light rating just means that you are following the obligations under the First Amendment. So pretty basic. Almost 40% of the schools that we surveyed received a red light rating, our worst rating. Now, that's down from 50% a year ago and 75% 9 years ago. So the percentage of schools with really egregious speech codes has gone way down. And that's thanks in large part to my colleagues' work with administrators and student advocacy, also letters from free speech allies like Congressman Bob Goodlatte, and of course a couple First Amendment lawsuits have helped too. But despite this progress, the vast majority of public colleges still maintain policies that are likely unconstitutional. And the vast majority of private colleges maintain policies that are at odds with each other. Furthermore, while speech is better protected on a lot of college campuses than it was a year ago, there are also some schools that have taken a step back by implementing new speech restrictive policies. And so they actually got a worse rating this year than they did last year. So keeping speech free on campus is an ongoing effort, and it requires constant vigilance. It's not always going to be an all-out war. Sometimes speech codes can be improved just by talking with administrators and explaining what the law is or what the practical benefits of free speech are, but it is a continuous process. And the fact that there was so much progress made in the 60s and 70s, and yet we're still battling censorship on college campuses today, is clear evidence of that. With so much work behind us and in front of us, it can be tempting to try to find someone to blame for our free speech problems. A lot of people are doing that. But if you're pointing the finger at just one group of people, you're wrong. It's important to remember that calls for censorship come from all places along the political spectrum. FIRE is proudly nonpartisan, but our critics have alternatively complained that we're too liberal or too conservative based on whatever we happen to be publicizing at the time or whatever article they happen to read about us. The truth is we've defended speech of all sorts of different ideologies because we've seen attempts at censoring and punishing speech of all different ideologies. Whatever your cause is, people who share your beliefs have probably been on both the censoring side and the censored side of a recent free speech debate. We've seen and spoken out against attempts at silencing Democrats, Republicans, libertarians, pro-life, pro-choice, pro-gun, pro-animal rights, pro-Israel, Palestine, anti-NSA, and pro-LGBT student activists, just to start. We've seen students punished for trying to spread awareness of free speech on campus or passing out copies of the Constitution. And as ridiculous as that seems, getting in trouble for passing out copies of the Constitution, we've seen that happen several times. The bottom line is, if you're advocating for broad speech codes, it's only a matter of time before someone uses one against you. So it's up to all of us to explain, not just to people who disagree with us, but also to people who share our beliefs, that protecting freedom of expression really only works if it's protected for everyone. So, as I said, blaming the problem on just one group of people isn't accurate, it's not helpful. And just like you can't say the current campus climate is solely the fault of liberals or conservatives, you also can't say that it's solely the fault of administrators or professors or students. Now, my colleagues and I at FIRE are disappointed to see an increase in calls for censorship or punishment of speech coming from students, whereas in the past, threats to free expression were more likely to just come directly from administrators. But individuals from all these groups have tried to silence people they disagree with, or even people whose speech is just a minor inconvenience. For more bad news, censorship isn't just limited to those in the campus community either. Lawmakers are now threatening schools that have course materials that they object to. So for example, this winter, Wisconsin state legislators threatened to withhold funding from the University of Wisconsin-Madison because of its course offering called The Problem of Whiteness. In 2014, the South Carolina legislature similarly used its budgeting power to punish two institutions in the state for including LGBT-themed books in their required reading for freshmen. Students can even get in trouble for expression based on complaints from people, just ordinary citizens that have no connection to the institution whatsoever. In 2015, a student at Texas Christian University was suspended for some Twitter posts about the Islamic State after a non-student posted screenshots of the tweets to her Tumblr and then wrote to TCU about them. And of course, when pictures or recordings from, we see this all the time, these racially themed parties, and the pictures go viral online, the uproar from the public can spur institutions to respond very quickly and punish everyone involved, regardless of whether the First Amendment actually permits such punishment. But arguably the most worrying threat to free expression on campus now, because of its nationwide power, is in the executive branch of the federal government. The Department of Education's Office for Civil Rights enforces Title IX, which forbids sex discrimination in schools receiving federal funding. For colleges and universities, that's all but a handful, maybe four, out of the thousands of institutions, and including private ones. And among other things, OCR helps ensure that schools address campus sexual harassment. As a reminder from before, the Supreme Court in 1999 drew the legal line between protected expression and punishable harassment. And it said that sexual harassment is discriminatory conduct so severe, pervasive, and objectively offensive that it effectively bars the victim's access to an educational opportunity or benefit. But in 2013, OCR and the Department of Justice told the University of Montana that they had to define sexual harassment as any unwelcome conduct of a sexual nature, and conduct includes speech. OCR and DOJ also wrote that their instructions to the University of Montana should be considered a blueprint for colleges nationwide to deal with sexual misconduct. So you'll notice that this new definition, any unwelcome conduct or speech of a sexual nature, doesn't have any requirement that the speech be objectively offensive, that it be severe or pervasive, or that it have a concrete effect, like preventing someone from receiving their education. It simply requires a subjective feeling that speech is unwelcome. So how could this play out? Well, if you're talking about, for example, the details of being transgender with some peers, and one of your classmates with an earshot has a personal don't ask, don't tell policy, you've committed sexual harassment. Or if you're doing an impromptu dramatic reenactment of Billy Bush and the president-elect on Access Hollywood, and your audience hates the word pussy, as I'm sure some of you do, you've committed sexual harassment according to OCR and the DOJ. Their definition of sexual harassment is already codified in school policies across the country. And depressingly, it's being enforced as broadly as it's written. For just one example, a former Louisiana State University tenured professor of education was fired under a similarly written sexual harassment policy. She had previously been widely lauded for her contributions to the Louisiana State education system. But then she told a joke about lesbians wearing brown pants. And she used the word pussy a few times in the context of telling her students some language that they could potentially expect to hear in the course of doing their future jobs. And she was fired for that. Now, with FIRE's help, she's suing LSU for violating her First Amendment rights. But she shouldn't have to sue in order to avoid this sort of overreaction to expression that's plainly protected under the First Amendment. So what can we do to try to push back against this social sensitivity movement, as the program calls it? Of course, I have to say, especially to students and professors, that you can always contact FIRE if you're punished or censored for your speech, or censored if your speech is protected. Aside from our undefeated Stand Up for Speech litigation project, our letter writing to schools and our intense public shaming of schools frequently wins victories that help thousands of students at once. And we should all vocally support administrators who do the right thing in the face of these calls for censorship or demands for compelled speech. These demands by students are themselves protected expression. Students can ask for pretty much whatever they want, and they can't be punished by the school for asking for those things. It's just that it's often unconstitutional for schools to accept those demands and act based on them. So remember, administrators are under a lot of pressure, so apply pressure in favor of free expression. But it's also critically important to participate in the marketplace of ideas. There's been a controversy over a professor watch list created by Turning Point USA, and it's been called a blacklist. I would call it more of a news aggregator. But in any case, it lists professors that this group, TPUSA, objects to for one reason or another. But we all have to do our research. So read the links and decide for yourself whether a professor on this list is really objectionable because they hinder student speech, or whether maybe TPUSA just doesn't like their liberal message. Maybe the list is a mix of both. It's TPUSA's right to publicly criticize professors and repost articles about them. They're allowed to do that under the First Amendment. But keep an eye out in case the list is used as a basis for punishment down the line. I haven't seen that happen yet, although some of the professors on the list were punished before the list was published. But watching carefully never hurts. And whenever you don't like another person's expression, including if you don't like when your classmates are calling for censorship or punishment of speech, then contribute your own expression to the public arena. Be prepared to make up for the fact that others might not be willing or able to speak out or tell the truth. Things might seem chaotic right now. Some newly vocal groups have been thrust into the spotlight during and since the presidential election. To students especially, I want you to take advantage of what's out there right now. A lot of people are being really blunt. So appreciate the fact that you can get a better picture of what the nation's really thinking. Find people who disagree with you and try to hone your argumentative and reasoning skills, whether that's arguing in favor of free expression or explaining the benefits of sensitivity or debating on the merits of social or political ideas. And have confidence. The movement towards required social sensitivity might seem really strong at times, but if you prefer a different tone, the law is on your side. And with that, I will pass it on to my fellow panelists.
Thank you, Ms. Kruth. We hope we'll be able to delve a little deeper into some of the points you made during the discussion phase. But now, let's look at some of the constitutional aspects of free speech suppression. She touched on them a little bit, but I'm going to look to our next presenter to bring that point of view and expertise to it. He is Dr. Louis Varelli III. He's a law professor at Stetson University College of Law here in St. Pete. And as you can see in his bio, he has taught and written about constitutional law. So Dr. Varelli, give us the context from the First Amendment from the Constitution.
Well, first, I want to thank all of you for being here. It's an exciting topic, and it's a big room, and that's always a good sign. I'm really grateful to SBC and to David for including me. I'm also in a very familiar position. I am not nearly the most qualified person to talk on the topic that I'm talking about, so I'm really good at that. I say as little as possible, and then I sit down, and if you want to hear more from me, you can ask me questions. So I have a few things I think are probably worth saying that haven't been touched on, because I come at this from the constitutional law perspective, particularly the perspective of the courts. So Susan already did a very good job, and much better than I could have, at laying out sort of what the landscape looks like in the First Amendment context on campuses. Public schools and private schools are very different under the Constitution. The Constitution only provides rights to citizens against their government. My first-year students are always very surprised to hear that, so I tell them that several times over the course of our 13-week semester. If you want rights against another private actor, you need to get them legislatively. So from a private school perspective, Congress may or may not have a role to play, and I don't have a strong position about that. But in terms of institutionally, I sort of want to lay the groundwork. Primarily, when we're talking about the First Amendment, or exclusively when we're talking about the First Amendment, we're going to be talking about public schools or public institutions. So what I was thinking about adding to this, to the extent I'm capable at all, is to talk about sort of where the courts are, what the courts are likely to do in this arena, and particularly what the Supreme Court of the United States is likely to do. You've heard of that. You know that we're missing one of them right now, and we're going to have a new justice soon, and I think that's going to be relevant. But before we get that far, a little bit of how I think this is likely to play out at the top level, because it's sort of it's a relatively easy story in the lower courts. And by lower courts, I mean federal trial courts and federal courts of appeal. And the reason it's relatively easy is that those courts are easy to get to. So if you have a speech code on campus in a public school, and you object to it, or you have a grounds for bringing suit against that school based on their speech code, you're going to federal trial court. You have a right to be there. Nobody's stopping you from doing that. And if you lose, you have a right to appeal to a federal circuit court. That's what we call our courts of appeals, circuit courts of appeal. So those two levels of court are seeing all of the cases, to the extent there are many of them. And they're doing a pretty good job of striking down the overwhelming majority, if not all, of the speech codes they're coming in contact with, for reasons that we'll talk about in a minute. If and when the Supreme Court gets involved in this veritable brouhaha, it's going to be a different story. And that's because the Supreme Court controls its docket. The Supreme Court chooses the cases it hears, and it doesn't choose the easy ones. So that's actually the best way I defend the court to my students. Every time they get loaded for bear to talk about what the court did wrong, and they may be right about the court being wrong, it happens, is that I explain to them, well, they take the hard cases. If a case gets that far, it's because there isn't an easy answer. They're not working for the sake of working, although they are very hardworking people. So what kind of role could the Supreme Court play in this? Well, how do they choose their cases? Right? First of all, they have to be asked to take a case by the litigants. And they are asked to take, I think it's 2,000 plus a year, and they take 80, because that's how many they have time to decide. In order to get a case chosen, four of the nine, or in this case, four of the eight justices have to agree to take it. So you have almost half of the justices agreeing a case is worth deciding. What do they think about? They think about the close cases, and they think about cases that the lower courts can't agree about. So right now, we have relative uniformity in the speech code context. Schools are regulating speech. The courts are telling them they can't do it. The Supreme Court's not going to be involved in that process because there's nothing to fix, there's nothing to clarify, there's no uniformity problem. When the court decides cases, obviously it decides them by majority vote. Those assignments as to who writes the opinion in a Supreme Court case are relevant. They're made by the most senior justice on the winning side when they take an initial vote. So all of these things become relevant. When you see a 5-4 vote and the Chief Justice is in the five, in the majority, he's going to write it because he can. It's his prerogative to assign it to himself. When you see a case that's more controversial and they had to sort of coax a justice to their side, that justice will write it because that justice was brought over to the majority with the promise that you get to write the decision and help frame the law. That's why in the ugliest of cases, you'll see Justice Kennedy writing a lot, because he's the swing vote. And if you have Kennedy, you win, and you may have to let him write it to get him. So those are all just sort of institutional facts, right? They have nothing particular to do about the First Amendment. But as we see these cases come through, and as we're talking about how the courts, and particularly the highest court, is going to deal with them, it's worth knowing what the process looks like, sort of how the sausage is made. These are nine, in my mind, principled, qualified people, eight right now, soon to be nine. But they are working within an institution that has rules, and they are using those rules to get to results. So what kind of case are we going to see in this context? We're going to see a close one. It's going to be the kind of case that looks, for example, like a hate crime. So you're going to, in my view, right, I don't have any, I know nothing more specifically about what the justices are thinking than any of you all. They haven't called me. But I can tell you, but in my view, the kind of case that's going to percolate to the top is going to be the kind of case that looks like a regulation that we are already comfortable with or that is already on the books, like hate crime laws, right? So speech codes that focus on what is viewed by the legislature as particularly offensive or more easily definable speech, speech that seeks to incite or to exclude or whatever. Again, not taking a position whether that's a good idea, but I think that's one kind of case. The other kind is the quasi-government speech case. Right, so when speech on campus looks like it's coming from the university, we have a totally different set of criteria to apply. And there's been a bunch of cases like that have come down the pike recently. So what I'm doing is I'm kind of creating categories that I have data for, because the Supreme Court hasn't decided a speech code case. But they've decided First Amendment cases sort of around the issues that are going to come up in this context. So what is the court likely to do? Well, I went back for the last few terms, and I don't know, it wasn't a scientific review. I did a lot of Googling and so forth, but I recognized most of the names. And I looked at what the court's been doing in the First Amendment for the last 5 or 6 years, and I had a hunch, but it turns out I was right. The First Amendment wins all the time in this court, and I'm not bemoaning that result, it's just fact, that wins all the time. The one case that could be described as a First Amendment loss, so a case where free speech didn't prevail, is a case called Williams-Yulee versus the Florida Bar. And in that case, it was a speech restriction on judges running for office. And it's a case near and dear to my heart because I've authored a book recently about Supreme Court recusal, and this case was a big part of the book, so I was paying attention. And we found the Supreme Court saying, the First Amendment doesn't trump here. In other words, you can limit a candidate's speech when they are running for judicial office because the Constitution puts judges in a place that is different. So you have a constitutional principle balancing the First Amendment consideration. You have judicial independence, which is enshrined in Article 3 of our Constitution, sort of on the other side of the ledger from the First Amendment. It took something of that magnitude for this court to say, you know what, judges have to keep quiet. They can't solicit campaign contributions on their own because it's going to inhibit their independence. Their independence is a matter of constitutional magnitude. One constitutional provision against another constitutional provision, we have to pick one, First Amendment loses. It took that in the recent past for the Supreme Court to say, you know what, we're willing to accept a speech restriction. They're not, this court is very speech friendly. And again, I'm not bemoaning that, just describing it. What kinds of cases fall under the court's First Amendment docket? Well, the easiest ones are viewpoint discrimination cases. So the First Amendment creates different perspectives from the bench, from the judges, depending on exactly how it affects speech. The worst version, according to the First Amendment, is what we call viewpoint discrimination, content-based discrimination. Basically a statute that says you can't say X, speech code, the kind of things we're seeing on college campuses. The court rains down merciless energy on those cases, and they fail. They fail miserably. They are faced with a legal standard called strict scrutiny, which means if you want to pass a law that says you can't say X, you have to show that there's a compelling government interest in doing it, that there's a really serious government need for doing it, and that your restriction is as narrow as possible to achieve that government interest. Very, very difficult to do, and that frankly doesn't work. There was a case 2 years ago called Reed, which was about sign restrictions, laws about signage in a little town in Arizona. And a church was putting up signs telling people how to get to church. And the town had different rules for those kinds of signs than other kinds of signs. And I think it said they could only be 6 feet square, and they could only be up from noon the day before until the morning of, and all these things that the church wasn't doing. And the church had gotten in trouble. And they sued, and the court said, no, you can't do that. You can't single out that message. And all the message was there's church. And it didn't matter that it was church. It could have been there's the flea market, there's the farmer's market, there's the Little League game. If you target a particular kind of speech, you are in trouble. And the court resonated with that and reaffirmed that viewpoint discrimination is ill-fated. And that's relevant here because the speech codes that are around now, as I read them, and I'm not the expert, Susan is, but the speech codes that I'm seeing on campuses are clearly viewpoint discrimination. You can't say this thing because it will offend. They're in trouble in that regard. Disparaging speech, speech that is admittedly or objectively disparaging. Well, this is, I mean, talk about falling into something good, right? Yesterday, the Supreme Court heard an argument in a case called Lee v. Tam. So I'm minding my business, thinking about what I'm going to talk to you all about, and this argument schedule walks right into my wheelhouse, and now I get to talk about this. Lee v. Tam, if you've heard of it, is a trademark case, which gets a universal groan from the audience, and I don't blame you. I'm the son of a patent lawyer, and I still don't find trademarks interesting. But this case is interesting in this regard. The trademark-seeking party is a band called The Slants. They are an Asian American band. The term slant is a disparaging term. They have chosen that term on purpose in an attempt to re-empower the term or take back the term. The trademark office rejected their application because there's a law that says you can't get a trademark on a disparaging term. And the law's been there for a long time. It is the reason that currently the Washington Redskins trademarks have been revoked, and they are on appeal. The court heard argument yesterday, so we have the transcript of what went on. And usually it's bad news for both lawyers when you read these transcripts. It's never a pretty picture when you're in front of the court, because they do a pretty good job of dismantling everybody. This one was relatively clear. They did not like the idea that the Patent and Trademark Office is going to be deciding whether or not a trademark is disparaging enough to fail. What was interesting was the one argument that got a little bit of oxygen in the room was, well, when the government gives you a trademark, it is endorsing that speech. It is sanctifying it, right? It's protecting it. It's giving you a legal right to it. The justices didn't get too excited about that, but they at least brought it up to opposing counsel. Right? There was enough energy spent on it that we can imagine that issue resonated with them. And that's not inconsistent. There have been other government speech cases recently where the court has sided against the argument for free expression. Government speech is quite different, right? Because if the government is speaking, then of course it doesn't have to let other people tell it what to say, is the idea. And there was a case called Summum almost 10 years ago, where it was decided that a town in Utah did not have to let somebody put up a religious monument in a public park, because by definition, putting up a monument in a public park constituted government endorsement of that monument. That was the court's view. There was a recent case called Texas Sons of the Confederacy, where there was a dispute about whether you could get a vanity plate with the Confederate flag on it, and the state of Texas said no. And Justice Thomas, writing for the court, Justice Thomas, normally an avid free speech advocate, said, you know what? A license plate's government speech. It's understood by readers to reflect the state's point of view. And in that regard, the government can decide what it wants to say. It can decide what's going to be on its license plate. So the government speech angle is our closest angle, and it's possible that institutions of higher learning could find themselves in a place where the speech that is going on campuses appears to be endorsed by that institution. That is sort of the window where all of this is possible. In terms of the vacancy on the court, Justice Kennedy will no longer be the swing, or it will remain the swing. We're very much likely to see a continuation of the court's current protectionist practices regarding speech. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Varelli. Let's set this issue in a sociological perspective. I would like to welcome to the stage Dr. David Liebert. In addition to being a professor and academic department chair for social and behavioral sciences here at St. Petersburg College, Dr. Liebert is a published author and a licensed mental health counselor. And if he would come to the stage now and provide that sociological context. Thank you.
How's everybody doing tonight? All right. So I spent nearly 20 years in the college classroom. And like so many of the classes that I start, at the beginning of the hour. I'm going to ask you a question. Now, I don't have a text for you to text in. We're just going to do it old school. Raise your hand. Do you agree? Are you allowed to say fire in a theater? I'm looking at the lawyers.
Depends on how you say it.
Loudly. I don't want to get in trouble, so I'm not going to say it loudly. A crowded theater. May you yell fire in a crowded theater? Okay. Okay. Now I want you to hang in there with me for just a moment. Unless there's an actual fire. Makes sense. I'm going to throw out perhaps what might seem a bit of an odd suggestion. I'm going to argue that the one place we ought to be allowed to say fire is in a classroom. Classroom is such a different institution and place than any other location. Actually, the psychologist in me has to give you a little quick psychology lesson. Not only was the word fire said, they actually almost lit one in a college classroom, all for the sake of research. This goes back to the early 1970s. Two social psychologists, names were Darley and Latane. Remember, Latane's name was Bib Latane. That's just a cool name. Can't not remember that first name. Well, they actually had a student go into a classroom by him or herself to complete a survey. And the survey was just kind of a benign survey to kill 20 minutes. But unknown to the student, in the room adjacent to the classroom, the researchers lit a smoke bomb, and smoke began to pour through the vent into the classroom. Every time the student got up and went to go seek help, believing that there was probably a fire in that room. Now what Darley and Latane did is they took the student, another student, put them in a classroom with four, five, six other students completing the same survey. Again, benign survey, taken 20 minutes to complete. The other students in the room, however, were Confederates. They knew what was going to happen. The smoke bomb would be lit in about 2 minutes, and the classroom would start filling with smoke. But in this instance, the one student in the room who did not know what was going on, in most instances, stayed and continued to complete their survey, even though every sense in their body is screaming, this room is probably on fire and we should go get help. Let me get to my point. I know as teachers, we're always told, what's the point? What's the point? Here we go. Colleges and universities represent a social institution. This is a vital social institution. This institution provides primarily two essential vital roles to our society. First, colleges and universities create knowledge. For example, Darley and Latane's research, we refer to it as the bystander effect. Even all these years later, we teach about it in our psychology classes, sociology classes, ethics classes, because by teaching this valuable lesson, this piece of knowledge, we know, and now you all actually know, that if you arrive upon a scene where perhaps it might be helpful to call for some help, you are much less likely now to say, somebody else in this room will do it. I'm sure somebody else has called. You're actually now more likely to engage and ask for that help. In other words, Darley and Latane's research has actually, by this date, has saved many, many lives because we continue to talk about it in the classroom. This is a vital, vital role that colleges and universities provide, is the creation of knowledge. Now again, I've spent nearly 20 years in the college classroom. And in those 20 years, my primary fundamental role has been a teacher. I always refer to myself as a classroom teacher. I'm not a researcher. And the second most vital role that colleges and universities provide is teaching students. The most valuable tool we have in higher education is to engage our students in critical thinking. And the primary tool we use to engage students in critical thinking is free speech. I have to, as a teacher, be able to look at my students without them knowing what side of the fence I may be on, where I may have to play devil's advocate, and challenge them. The classroom is not supposed to be a theater, it's a classroom. Students aren't supposed to show up to my class, rip the top off their Pop-Tarts, pop their Red Bull, sit back and enjoy the lecture. They're supposed to be challenged. And at times, the classroom is supposed to be an uncomfortable place to be. When I teach a class in abnormal psychology, and we get to the chapter on substance abuse, I will engage a conversation. Is substance abuse, is alcoholism a disease? I mean, a disease as you would define a disease according to the medical model. Or is it really voluntary compulsive behavior? And I appreciate that students walk into my classroom with a set of values and beliefs. And on that subject, so often those values and beliefs may have actually been earned in the school of real life. But that question that I pose concerning the nature of alcoholism, I'll tell you straight, we don't have an absolute answer to that question. There is still debate that goes on regarding that question. I want students to see both sides of the fence. I want them to feel uncomfortable because it's in that friction that occurs when you're able to look at both sides, argue both sides, that you have that spark of learning, what in education we refer to as the teachable moment. Institutions of higher education, not only are they institutions that meet two vital social needs by producing knowledge and being a place where we educate folks to be critical thinkers, but social institutions like higher education also need to listen to the various stakeholders. We are not a stagnant institution. We change and we evolve over time. Colleges and universities will, for instance, listen to local employers. What type of skills do they want the students that we graduate to be able to do for them? We'll listen. And we also listen to our students as well. What type of programs, what type of curriculum do they want in the classroom? And I've heard the term used, I saw a few slides regarding millennials. The students that we have in our classrooms today, the younger cohort, do fall into that category of being millennials. According to the data, this is a group of student that does tend to be more orientated towards the left politically. This is a student that perhaps is more likely to believe in their specialness and don't like to be offended. They do have this idea of wanting to sit back in the classroom and enjoy the lecture without being stressed or being offended by the ideas that we are proposing. This notion of a microaggression that we have heard about, it's really come out of this dialogue. Microaggressions, as I see it, is the language that's really beginning with the student, that we can't do anything offensive in the classroom. Yesterday in my psychology class, only because I'm thinking about these topics, I was starting a unit concerning Sigmund Freud. Trigger warning. And oftentimes, because students feel a little bit taken back right at first, I start with a children's story. I bring in a copy of Marie Senek's book, Where the Wild Things Are, very analytic book. And one of the students, a non-traditional student, perhaps even a little bit older than myself, simply kind of called out, perhaps in jest, "We should all sit on the floor Indian style," as if we're in kindergarten. I thought, oh, microaggression. We can't use such language in the classroom, potential offense. But this is where the language is coming out regarding microaggressions. And again, I'd like to remind you all, the psychologist in me has to say, this is not a recognized pathology. It's not in our DSM-5. But the idea is, with enough microaggressions, you know, it's PTSD through 1,000 insults. Lastly, this institution that we call higher education, like all institutions, is a very diverse institution. And I do want to call to everyone's attention and remind everyone, although we're talking about the academy, there are many different kinds. Conversation we were just having around the table prior to the start of dinner. Even if you just simply read the mission statement of various colleges and universities, you'll see that they differ widely if we're talking about a military college, a faith-based college, a community college. And when I look at the students that I've encountered over the last 20 years, honestly, I don't see a lot of this occurring in my classrooms. I know it's occurring in other classrooms. And when I talk to my faculty around the coffee pot, and we talk about, you know, the next devastation to come around the corner, the next fear that's going to put us out of business, and I hear faculty talking about the MOOCs, and the MOOCs are going to do away with teaching. It's all going to be online without instructors. That doesn't concern me. The topic that we're here looking at tonight, this is what scares me regarding the classroom. You take away my capacity as a professor to engage critical thinking, my ability for free speech to challenge my students in the classroom. You're very quickly turning my classroom into the 13th grade. We become a high school with ashtrays at that point. When Mr. Clement had asked a few months ago if I would be willing to come here and talk tonight, truthfully, I very quickly thought about Darley and Latane, and can't assume that somebody else will do it. So I really appreciate your time listening to me, and I can't wait to hear what kind of questions you all have. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Liebert. I hope you agree with me or with the way I'm thinking that I feel better about the state of higher education by hearing a professor like him talk about how he wants to challenge his students to think critically. So let's first have a little discussion. We want to bring you in the conversation now by looking at the results of the first question that, in our instant survey about political correctness. And the results are 80% agree that people should be free to speak without worrying about being politically correct. 12% disagree and 8% are undecided. Now, in the slides that we showed during dinner and before dinner, the Pew survey showed 71% think that they should be able to say whatever they want without fear of censorship. So we are not that far off from a national figure, but somewhat higher. I was wondering if you all had a chance to talk about that question while you were eating, if anyone would like to offer a quick comment, minute or so, about what you all thought at the tables. And wait for a microphone, please, so we're videoing it. At this table here, a gentleman.
How could this business about free speech have trickled down to the academia level when the president-elect has absolutely no regard for what he says, who he offends, and he's the president-elect? How could it have trickled down to affect the academic community?
Another comment from a table? Let's hear. Students, facilitators, do you have something you heard? There's one, Jacqueline, over there. The lady there.
Well, I'm a public school teacher here in Pinellas County, and to address what this gentleman said, I teach third grade in a Title I school with largely a large Mexican population. And you ask how it trickles down into academia. My third graders, it has trickled down because speech and words affect everybody's life. Now, I'm not saying censor them, I'm just saying they affect people.
Thank you.
I quite agree with you.
Thank you.
If the person in charge is held to a higher standard.
Bring the mic in so we can all hear, please.
I'm
sorry? If the president-elect doesn't set an example for what he expects his countrymen to do, there's something wrong with that picture. Is he going to be brought to task? Is he going to be charged with crossing the line between free speech and social sensitivity? He certainly has done that with just about every racial, he's done that with everyone. He's offended somebody with something he said. Will he be prosecuted?
There's one behind you. Now, this is just about, this is about the question on political correctness. We'll get to general questions.
My turn.
Go ahead.
My turn. Thank you. Does each sociological group determine what is politically correct? Is there a universal description or standard of what is politically correct? Because we have a classroom and we have business. What is politically correct?
I would ask anyone on the panel want to take that? They're on, Susan, always. It should be on. The soundboard controls it.
Testing? Oh,
yeah.
Okay. I think everyone has different definitions of politically correct, and there's some that are more common, but I think that it's clear from watching all these public figures say, oh, well, you know, you're just getting upset over Trump's comments about grabbing women because you're politically correct. I mean, even the fact that people are saying things like that, to me, makes clear that people do have different definitions of politically correct. So I'm not going to try to define it. I'm just going to say that I think there's no real agreement on it.
Go ahead, Lewis.
So I'm certainly not an expert on what the definition of politically correct is, but I think in my classroom, I agree that free speech is critical. But I also feel as if there's from a legal point of view, there's a crossing of paths. And I think there was a controversy with Dr. Laura, the radio host, years ago, but I think it sort of tells a big story. There's a big difference between censorship and accountability, right? So censorship is not appropriate. We have a First Amendment protection against that. But we are accountable to each other for what we say in front of one another. And if we have upset somebody and we wished not to, my view is I'm willing to accommodate the person I didn't intend to upset by trying to find a new way to say that. In my experience, my initial mistake has never been fatal to the relationship. So I want to make sure that legally we know what we're talking about. Censorship is the power, at least one definition of censorship, is the power of the state prohibiting you from saying something. I think folks have taken that, and some folks have taken that to one end of the spectrum and said, I choose not to be accountable for what I say to anybody, and people should be willing to hear me and accept uncritically anything I choose to say to them. And that's not the free speech deal. That's not the First Amendment arrangement.
Hey, go ahead, David. Yeah.
From a sociological perspective, one of the challenges we always face when we talk about what might also be defined as a social problem, when we talk about and explore social problems from a political point of view, it tends to be polarized. These are very complex issues that are not either right or left. The challenge that I see with using terminology like political correctness, it tends to polarize one side or the other in lieu of concepts that might actually reach more towards the middle or the gray, like simple civility.
Okay, let's consider a second instant survey. Jonathan, if you would post it, please. This brings it down to the college level and the speech codes that we heard about from the panel. Colleges should be free to enforce speech codes to ban offensive kinds of speech, such as racist and sexist. Again, you vote by texting 22333, the number, and you should already be logged in, so you don't have to retype in the word. And here's the question, and you vote agree by A, disagree by B. Well, 15 more seconds. Anybody still trying to vote? Okay, let's stop it there. 59, 61, all right, 61, 25, and 14. The Pew survey that I cited earlier for a national comparison, 26%, this was an average of all the generations, mine, boomers, Gen X, and millennials, 26% agreed with this statement. So we are almost exactly the same as the Pew survey nationally. Anyone at the tables would like to comment on this? Here's a student.
Thank you, Matt.
It's Ron.
Okay, excellent. I have a question for you, ma'am. Out of all the campuses across the country, which you have surveyed for red light, green light, and whatnot, which would you say is the most egregious?
I think we recently wrote a blog post that you'd probably be interested in on our website, thefire.org, asking if DePaul was the worst campus for free speech. I think there's a lot of competition for, you know, worst campus for free speech, but lately it just seems like they keep doing things to censor and punish students for protected expression. I don't think that that's true at all times of all the years that I've been at FIRE, but they do keep popping up.
Any other comments from the table?
Yeah, my question is, it says colleges should be free to enforce speech codes to ban racist or sexist speech. Who determines what speech is racist or sexist?
Aren't there some common standards for that?
I would say yes.
Culturally? How about Dr. Liebert? Would you like to?
Well, I appreciate that from a cultural point of view that, yes, we may have some assumptions. Now, again, I'm thinking about in the classroom. How do we really know what constitutes racism, sexism, if we're not willing to explore the concepts in the classroom? In a sociology class, for instance, I tend to suggest to my students, we drop the word race, and we really use, in return, use the term ethnicity. Physical anthropologists will tell us, for instance, that, you know, over the centuries, we've just, you know, found the opposite sex too darn attractive, and we wander around this earth too much to say there is such thing as a pure race. So to look at distinctions and differences in folks, which may have true meaning in a classroom, to look at subcultures, ethnicity is actually a better term to be used. And I could go on for half an hour as to why that would be quite correct. But if I can't talk about the limitations of the term race or racism and talk about the advantages of a term like ethnicity, you are stifling my ability to teach my students.
My African American friends will have told me that there is only one race. It's the human race, and that the race is a construct of us putting that onto people who aren't like us. One more question or comment on the speech codes from the audience before we get into some of the other points.
Yeah, I got a comment on the speech code. I feel as if the speech codes were put into place, it would eventually trickle down to our papers our students have to write, and it would mix a bunch of stuff up in writing papers and APA and MLA format. We would have to switch it all up. And if I'm writing like a 2,000 word paper on a case about rape or something, there's going to be some speech codes in there. I'm going to try and get a good grade. It's going to be very edgy and stuff, and I feel like it would trickle down to our papers we got to write, and almost we have to like reteach and teach different things almost to learn how not to say certain things and everything. I think feel like it'd go down to the paper and stuff. I really do. Like we'd be learning differently almost.
Thank you. Jacqueline, here's one in front.
Just playing devil's advocate and giving a different point of view, could these speech codes be intended for social interactions? You know, maybe some kids are being harassed by racial epithets. And so this is the rule the college is saying, socially, not in a classroom. I understand your point of view in a classroom. But socially, that, no, you can't call your friend or your neighbor these terms. Is that a possibility?
I think that social interactions are just as important to protect as like official classroom discussions. But when it comes to harassment, you can punish harassment if it rises to the level that the Supreme Court defined. And that's essentially it's when it starts to, when it interferes with someone receiving their education, that can be prohibited and punished even in public schools. But before that, if you're just, you're using the term in sort of the colloquial sense, people get upset over things. That's not to say it's not valid, but you can't punish speech just because it bothers people, because lots of really important conversations bother people, and there's just no way to draw the line if it's not. I think there's no real way to draw the line if it's not where the Supreme
Court drew it. But what if there are some bullies? They're constantly picking on a kid.
Well, right. So
that's what I'm thinking of.
The kinds of situations that you're thinking of mm-hmm. are probably things that would be considered harassment under the Supreme Court definition. If someone, especially if it involves any sort of physical actions, mm-hmm. Then that doesn't have the same speech freedom of speech implications. If it's continual every day, those are the sorts of facts that are more likely to lead to a finding that that is harassment mm-hmm. that can be punished.
Okay, I'd like to move on to some more general questions. But I would like to ask the panel regarding the political correctness results of 80% of this group agrees that there should be none. Yet in the context of what you said about not offending people, what do you think of that result, that 80% in regard to political correctness, that it should not be a factor?
What do I think of the result?
That 80% of the people here say they should be able to freely speak their mind without worrying about being politically correct, as our president-elect says that he believes.
I think, first of all, I think that part of my hesitance, I guess, with this question is that I feel like, and this is not meant as a dig at all, but I think that a lot of times this question gets sort of a positive, free speechy type result, but then when the next question asks about specific speech, the result is less speech protective. And so I always sort of, I guess what I would say is that I take results with sort of a grain of salt. But at the same time, I've seen different communities have such a wide range of what they think about this sort of issue that no results really surprise me at this point. I guess that's what I'd have to
say.
I know better to take on 80% of a room this size, so I won't do that. But I think my original comment was driven by that poll question, right? So I think when I think of political correctness, I think of it as a procedural mechanism. And it's important that we understand that the right to say something means the right to not be formally punished for saying it. That doesn't mean the right to have it accepted unconditionally, right? So free speech comes with free dissent in return. And I think our president-elect doesn't do that at all, right? His version of political correctness is, I get to call you whatever I want and you have to take it. And if I'm wrong about that, then we can talk about that separately. But if that's what he means and that's what I hear him saying, and I could be wrong, but that's what I hear, that, and I've heard other people take that position too, I think that point of view is does a disservice to free speech and is a better version of the political correctness concept, right? Which is, I'm going to be accountable to people, but not punished for offending.
Anything to add?
Well, as I look at the range and diversity that's in the room, the numbers that I see actually don't surprise me. I think that would be pretty consistent.
Okay. Regarding political correctness, I think a lot of it has to do, well, especially on college campuses, which with none of you mentioned this term, with cultural appropriation. Certain ethnic groups object to people not of that ethnic group of appropriating their culture, sometimes to make fun of it, such as Halloween costumes. That is a big issue on college campuses around Halloween. But then you alluded to the term Redskins for the Washington football team. That's an example of political correctness that some would say is going too far because it's a term for a football player. So would you like to talk about that? You know, as far as cultural appropriation, is that a legitimate reason to suppress my speech? Susan.
I think that the issue of cultural appropriation is one that needs to be fought in the marketplace of ideas. I think that it would be impossible to consistently punish, and I've seen a lot of examples lately that illustrate this, where you know, one person wears the clothes of a certain culture or eats the food of a certain culture, and then they get called out on it, and then surprise, it turns out that they actually are that culture, and just everyone thought they were white or whatever. And I mean, it's just impossible to police on that level. And just again, it's always that question of, well, who decides what crosses the line? Cultures borrow from each other all the time, and sometimes it's encouraged by, whatever main group of people we're talking about. So, I think it's impossible to police. If you're offended by something, it's totally your right to tell the person who offended you and to try to explain to them why you think that they shouldn't be doing whatever they're doing, but that should come from the citizens, not from the government.
Well, many colleges are having costume codes, from what I read, because of this very thing for Halloween, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's definitely a thing that's happening. It's just a thing that shouldn't be happening because it's either unconstitutional or in conflict with private colleges' promises of free expression.
Dr. Liebert, from an anthropological point of view, is this a legitimate reason to be politically correct?
Well, I'm more intrigued by the question as an academic question. Again, I'll draw on a comment that I made in my presentation. Not all colleges and universities are the same. We do have different cultures. And when I hear about like Halloween costumes, I just think this is occurring more often at those colleges and universities where the students start their day with a shower. I teach a lot of students who kind of end their day taking a shower. I don't see this in my classroom or on my campus as being something that students are up in arms with. They have other concerns in their life. Again, I find it as an interesting question from an academic point of view that we could be so offended by, a costume. You would assume that if you don't win the costume, contest, you go home the loser, you'll dress differently next year.
Okay. I'm sorry, I wanted to be formal, Ms. Kruth. Some major colleges and universities have made a point to say no speech codes, including the University of Chicago and Eckerd College here, have issued a formal statement saying we will not have a speech code. How do those colleges get away with not having a lot of complaints? And
you know, having no problems with people being able to say whatever they want.
Well, I think that all colleges are going to get complaints no matter what. It could be that for some colleges it's just happened to be a quiet period, but I think that any college that adopts the Chicago statement, the statement on free speech that you're talking about, I think any college that does that can expect complaints and should expect complaints, but it's just a matter of standing your ground when that happens. There's also some colleges that have adopted free speech statements, but still maintain the sort of policies that can be used to punish protected expression and placate the people who are calling for mandated civility and that sort of thing. So it's sort of complicated because everyone's always going to complain, but also because some schools are kind of having their cake and eating it too a little bit.
Well, I would just, if anyone is interested, recommend they Google University of Chicago or Eckerd College and read their statements about no speech codes. Let's talk about something that's near and dear to my heart, freedom of the press, which is a form of freedom of speech mentioned in the First Amendment, and a president-elect's statements about toughening libel laws. Dr. Verrilli, do you anticipate that if he would be able to prevail upon courts to do that, to make it easier to sue newspapers and magazines?
The lawyer in me just wants to say no and stop, because that's what I was taught to do when I was practicing lawyer. Now that I'm an academic, I can just keep going. So off we go. That protection comes from a famous Supreme Court case called New York Times v. Sullivan. The court sees it as a monumental, iconic case in its First Amendment lexicon. It's overwhelmingly unlikely in my mind that federal courts are going to be influenced by the president, and that's because of our constitutional structure, right? Federal courts are independent. Life-tenured judges with salary protection are in place in our system to do just that, to sort of hold that ground. Regardless of what you think about Sullivan, I think that's the kind of case that's not going away.
Okay. Anyone want to add to that?
I agree.
Okay. How about some questions from the audience? Now, I know I saw a lot of hands earlier, Jacqueline and Shantae, if you have mics. Here's one near the front. Please make it a question and state it in like 45 seconds or less, please.
Yes. Okay, so I don't know if you saw this article recently, Safe Spaces for Fascists. And the question that I have is a particular point they get into here, and that is to say at this one particular campus, what they were saying, there were college Republicans who wanted to have an event, but liberal students were threatening to shut it down. And so what the administrators seemed to say was, well, they can have their event, but we're going to charge them for the security costs. And what I want to know is, if someone tried to take that to court, I'd be interested in what you, Ms. Kruth, and Dr. Verrilli would think, how that would play out.
We'd like to.
Courts have actually found that that's not allowed. But a lot of schools do exactly that. They charge security fees. They say, look, the event you want to hold is going to be controversial and people might stir up trouble, so we're going to charge student groups for that security. And at a public school, that's not constitutional. And the Supreme Court has ruled clearly on that issue. So it's one of those issues where if you fight back against it, and FIRE has written a lot of letters to that point, and we've had some success with that. So a lot of the times you don't even have to take it to court, because once you point out the Supreme Court's precedent on that, schools kind of give up. But it happens a lot, and not everyone knows that they can fight back against that.
What one avenue schools do have is what we call a time, place, and manner restriction, right? So if there's a safety issue, you could move that demonstration someplace that was ostensibly safer, or provide a parallel dissent space that would, you know, sort of safely keep people apart, something like that. You can control where and when to the point, up to the line of effectively stifling, but charging somebody to do that is not going to work.
Okay, how about another question from the audience? Jacqueline, here's one in front.
I'd like to address something that Mr. Clement said about the Halloween costume debate. One of the main cases that I know was brought up was at Yale, and a lecturer was actually forced to step down due to the actual harassment she received from the students that actually viewed that as a good thing, as because Yale sent out an email that basically said, be cautious of what you do this Halloween, be cautious of, you know, the certain Halloween costumes you dress up as. And she sent out an email in response essentially to the whole faculty and staff and said, well, how much are we gonna enforce on this? How can you actually enforce what's racist, what's sexist and everything? Are we talking deliberate racism? Are we talking satirical racism or satirical sexism? Like, where do we draw the line? And she was actually forced to step down because of the harassment she received. So I just wanted to point that out as a sort of a counterpoint to how this can actually backfire in kind of a serious way.
Right. Any comment on that? I'm sure it's a very well-known case.
Yeah, I know the case you're talking about, and I think it's just incredibly unfortunate that she felt like she had to step down. And we always, at FIRE, you know, we always hope that professors can kind of tough it out as long as they know that they're in the right legally. But as just a human being, I understand that it's really hard for professors. And she and her husband were getting hammered every single day. I don't know if you guys saw the video of the professor. Was she a professor yet? Or a lecturer, yeah. I'm not sure her technical title. But yeah, and her husband, too, was basically surrounded by students. And there's videos of him trying to talk with them. And on the one hand, professors should be able to stand up for themselves and, you know, take the heat. But if the university is not sending the clear message that they're going to protect freedom of expression and protect their professors against, you know, potential punishment for their speech, that can be a really hard situation. So, oh yeah, sorry. So, like this gentleman said, the school sent out this email about a potentially offensive Halloween costumes, and then this woman, Erica Christakis, sent an email also to the campus community. Basically reminding people that you can't punish people for that sort of thing. Yale promises its students freedom of expression. So at that school, students should be allowed, if they want to wear offensive Halloween costumes, they should be allowed to do that under the campus policies. And just the suggestion that people are allowed to do this sort of thing really riled people up, and they objected to it. And they spoke very harshly against the email, but also there were calls for her to be fired, basically. Anytime that happens, I think a school needs to send a very clear message to the entire campus community that people will not be fired for speaking up in that manner. And anytime schools do not make that clear to their campus community, it really hurts it, I think.
I want to point out that that's a good example of the power of social media to shame. And it's used often, from what I've read, against faculty. And you, Ms. Kruth, advocated for us to use public social media to lobby against suppression. So it has it's a double-edged sword, that social media, as a shaming tool.
For a quick second. What also becomes a separate debate in and of itself, oftentimes, is the costs and benefits of tenure. But here's an instance where I think we could talk about the value of tenure for faculty.
Good point, and something that's under a lot of attack in higher education right now is tenure.
Yeah, I do want to say, though, that tenure helps, but we've seen a lot of tenured professors get fired or suspended too. Like the case that I was talking about earlier at Louisiana State University, she had tenure. But yeah, so it doesn't fix everything, but it does help sometimes.
Question in the back.
Hello. I just believe like a lot of things that people say they're offended by, they might need some mental help, because George Wallace was the governor of Alabama for over 30 years, I believe. And he had some of the worst speeches ever. You can YouTube that. But then you say we live in this sociocultural or whatever cultural society. We live in the American culture. Because the same thing that the kids do on my block, they do on your block. They do on the block over there. The worst speech you're going to hear is going to come from your home. But when you're coming to school and things are going on, well, yeah, anyone, I mean, whatever your opinion is about rape, yeah, that's cool. Maybe you don't need the subject there. But to say that we have to be politically correct, we've never been politically correct. No one can ever go out and say, this is what, like you're asking, well, what is politically correct? What is this? So, I mean, what's the debate about? I mean, you either watch your mouth or you don't, or someone can show you how to watch your mouth. Because truly, what you wear on Halloween, it don't matter. If I put on a Klan costume on Halloween, you're going to laugh.
You know what I mean? Because that's a joke.
Yeah, the question is this. Pretty soon, we're not going to be able to say anything, no matter what your culture is. Because we're going about politically correctness. What is politically correct?
Oh, here we go back to the same question we started the evening with. Can you answer him?
Well, as to the comment of eventually we won't be able to say anything, I mean, I think that's kind of true if things are left to just continue down their path without people fighting back against it. The kinds of comments that we've seen that get punished at colleges is just ridiculous. I mean, so, for example, we had one case where this girl yelled out a window. There was like a couple passing by underneath her dorm room, and she yelled out, "I hit it first," like as a joke. And she got charged with 5 conduct violations. And I mean, so it's offhand comments. It's, you know, there was a school newspaper that was investigated for just a straight reporting investigative piece on the school's Facebook confessions page. I mean, I can't even begin to go through all this stuff that just seems like it would be obviously protected or obviously innocuous, and yet it's targeted by administrators or by other students. And so, I mean, there's no... I don't see administrators drawing any line if we don't force them to.
Thank you. Any questions on this side of the room? We seem to be going all over there.
Excuse me.
That gentleman's are okay.
Yeah, this isn't necessarily really a question, but we've kept asking the question, what is political correctness? Seems to me that political correctness is a phrase that was invented by people who want to disparage the notion that we should be courteous to one another. If somebody doesn't want to be called the N-word, or if some Korean doesn't want to be called the K-word, or whatever, you know, if I don't do that, then I'm being sensitive. The suggestion was made that I can occasionally make a mistake and offend somebody. It's never been fatal for the relationship if I care about the relationship. If I don't care about the relationship, and there's people in high office who seems to not care about relationships, but if I don't care about a relationship, then I will call you what I want to call you. And then you can call me out for that. But political correctness was only a term that was developed to disparage the notion that we should really be courteous to one another.
Good point. Thank you, Mr. Lowe. Let's get somebody who hasn't had one first. Jacqueline, you have one back there.
Thank you. I would like to identify 4 violators of the freedom of expression. And after that, I will ask the panel whether or not it agrees with my statements, and was I politically correct? Yes. Violators of freedom of expression deny academic freedom to those who speak or write ill of the state of Israel. Violators of freedom of expression set up a surveillance group of students on campus who report on any college professor who speaks ill of Israel. Violators of expression won't publish letters to the editor that criticize criticize the state of Israel. And lastly, violators of freedom of expression won't have on their panel studying the Middle East a panelist critical of the state of Israel. In conclusion, I will quote one sentence from Gene Lyons, who is a reporter from the Arkansas Times, who on May 15, 1915, wrote an op-ed quite extensively, and he entitled it, "When Freedom of Expression Meets Bigotry." And he wrote, and I quote one sentence, "The right to free speech does not include the right not to be criticized." I repeat, the right to free speech does not include the right not to be criticized. Thank you.
Thank you, panel. I think that's that double-edged sword of...
Well, I agree, and I think that conversation is important from the legal perspective because there are rules about what the law can and cannot do in terms of punishing speech, but they pale in comparison to what sort of the cultural norms we create and foster can do to help frame debate. Having somebody take off that Halloween costume because they don't want to have to face somebody while they're wearing it is not censorship in my view, it's accountability. And I agree with you.
Go ahead.
So I'm trying to think of, remember all your four examples, and I think that there's a key distinction to be made between whether it's a host group, for example, hosting an event that just decides to include certain perspectives and not include other perspectives, between that situation and a situation where, for example, a public institution is telling a student group that they can include certain perspectives. The group itself is allowed to not necessarily include everyone's viewpoint. If they don't like, for example, if they don't like criticism of Israel, they're allowed to say, we're not gonna personally post those speakers. But it is a problem for free speech if a university, a public institution, says student groups cannot host these people. So I think it's just important to keep that in mind.
Can I add something, David?
Yes.
There are other legal norms at work here too, right? So if a public university excluded speakers on the basis of race, it's not a First Amendment problem, it's an equal protection problem, right? So there are other moving parts in this. Bullying turns into assault, right? We have a way to treat some of these things that aren't limited entirely to talking about the words that come out of people's mouths, right? So if people's ethnicity was the grounds to keep them off of a panel at a public institution, then we have a legal way to talk about that. It's not censorship, it's something else.
Dr. Liebert, any added comments?
I mean, I appreciate the comments that were being made. I tend to agree with what I'm hearing here.
Okay, Chante, do you have any questions on the left side of the room, that is?
The situation with Yale, it occurs to me, and this may be applicable in other situations too, wasn't that professor essentially the victim of harassment? And could not then the tables be turned against do you understand?
I don't know how to continue,
but in other words, the people that forced this woman to resign harassed her into it, apparently. Isn't there a legal remedy for that?
It could be that there are things that happened that I'm not aware of, but from the facts that I am aware of, I think that, you know, really heavy criticism doesn't rise to the legal definition of harassment. And I also think that the definition of harassment is especially narrow in the educational context because it's schools are the place where it's most arguably most important for everyone to be able to speak their mind without worrying about being punished, because it's where everyone's supposed to explore the entire range of possible ideas. And so I think that it's especially important for professors to be able to handle criticism and handle argumentative students. And again, it's one of those situations where on a human level, I'm not, you know, I'm not meaning to be very judgmental of her as a human being, but as a free speech advocate, I think we have to have a pretty high bar for what we expect professors to be able to handle. I'm not aware of students, you know, vandalizing her house or anything like that. So if it's, you know, what it looks like to me, which was just very strong disagreement and constant conversation, I mean, especially with her husband too, that's, I understand anyone being frustrated by that, but I think that that's the kind of thing that maybe we should expect professors to be able to deal with.
I would add to that, you know, in a classroom, it's not a democracy. I'm the one who's in charge of my classroom. And if I make a statement in the classroom or challenge a student to think critically in the classroom, I'm also responsible concerning what comes back at me. Now, again, there's a difference between somebody has vandalized my car, somebody is, you know, making horrible, you know, vicious statements. But if folks want to just inundate my email inbox, I can't believe that you said that in the classroom. I disagree with that idea. It's my job as a teacher to answer each of them emails.
Okay. Jacqueline, do you have a questioner?
Would you say the comments, the alleged racial comments, sexist comments, and homophobic comments by President-elect Donald Trump, would you say that they are politically correct and legally protected by the First Amendment?
They're not politically correct, they're politically incorrect. Are they protected?
Yeah, I was gonna say I'm not even gonna touch the PC question, but as far as whether they're protected by the First Amendment, I think they are. I think the one thing that arguably comes close to the line of whether it's protected was, and I would honestly, I would have to rewatch the tape to do a proper legal assessment, but in during the rally where he was urging people to get physical, and saying that he would pay their legal fees or whatever, that was a situation where I think that it arguably comes close to the line, if not crosses the line, of incitement to imminent lawless action. He knew that his audience was really riled up, that they might get physical, and he was trying to get them to get physical, and actually it worked because someone got elbowed in the face or whatever. And so of all the things that Trump has said, I think that potentially crosses the line, but the rest of what he's saying, I think is, I'm trying to go through the unprotected categories of speech in my head, but I really think that it's offensive to a lot of people, but I think that it's still constitutionally protected.
Dr. Verrilli?
I think that's right. I think it, that example, so the fact that we care more about what Donald Trump says is a sign of the alternatives to legal remedy in these sorts of situations, right? The real pushback for somebody who's saying things that we think do not befit an office is to put political pressure on that office, right? So you don't get to keep the office because we're going to pick somebody else next time who handles the office better, right? And that's the same as the Halloween costume. That's the same as campus pressure brought by other students to change the way you represent yourself or the way you speak to each other. That is a real thing that is inclusive of free speech and is culture moving, right? Much like what we teach our students in the classroom, we need to be able to push back and forth a little bit. The law doesn't always have to be the answer. I'm not suggesting you said it was, but so he's safe to say that, but there are consequences for him. And
but
the fact
Dr.
that we're all nodding
Verrilli,
our heads mean there are consequences.
If I may disagree, unique in my experience is that this leader is not paying any penalty for being politically incorrect. This is the first time that I'm aware of a high-level public official. So he is not being made to pay a price. That's the difference, and that's what's a huge element of this conversation. Would you agree?
I would agree that he may not have paid a price befitting his words, as the 100,000 votes in the three states the Electoral College revealed. But as I like to say to my friends to calm them down, every time speech like you mentioned comes to the public square, there is demonstrable pushback. And so his approval ratings fall when he talks, and they go back up when he's quiet. And I didn't do that scientifically, but I feel pretty good about that sentence. And I think that matters. I really do.
Okay. I'm looking at my watch, and it seems like we have time for about one more question. Who's got it? Some few people down here, some new folks.
Yes, sir.
Make it a good one.
Hello. I just wanted to say that regarding the president-elect until 12:30 tomorrow, let's not paint with a broad brush people who supported him, because just because people voted for someone does not agree and mean that they agree with everything he says or does. Would that not be correct?
Yes. Yeah, I think most of us would agree with that.
Okay.
Do you have a question? The gentleman with the mic has the question.
Oh, I did until I forgot.
All right. We didn't get one more question. Short, quick. Over here. Shantae? Okay. I'm sorry, I didn't see you.
Well, I think after the news press conference the other day, we are all concerned about freedom of the press. And I did hear a journalist say, in response to the president-elect not taking any certain questions, that the accountable thing to do would have been for them to all stand up and leave and not participate in that press conference. And it's how we respond and give credibility. And I think you're right. He is paying the price for these comments.
Thank you. Panel, response. That question and the other gentleman's comment about how we respond in large sense will determine the level of civility of our discourse, right?
We have the ability to respond every time we go to the poll booth. If we don't like what our officials are doing, we vote them out. We vote others back in. We are able to engage in that dialogue.
This will be your final comment. Maybe a little wrap up.
I think that it's valid to, for example, if you want to show how you feel by standing up and walking out of whatever situation, but I also think that there's value in staying and listening to someone, even if you know that you're not going to like what they're saying, and trying to engage with them. And you can't do that all the time because it takes a lot of energy, honestly, and none of us can be on all the time, but I think that when you do have the energy, it's worth sticking it out even when it's miserable and you don't think you could possibly make progress with someone.
I agree with that. Dr. Varelli.
I don't deserve to be last, but I will say on the press point, I do think it is a non-trivial part of our constitutional arrangement that our public leaders be accountable. We design our entire administrative law system around accountability and transparency, and the president has an obligation to answer questions at a press conference, period. Whether he likes them or not, it is viewpoint discrimination, much like a public university telling you you can't say something. It is viewpoint discrimination to exclude a credentialed member of the press corps from asking a question. You don't have to answer it, you have to listen to them.
But what body is going to require him to do that?
Nobody. Us. right? The press corps. I mean, this is where a professional press needs to be a professional press.
Okay.
I know. Dr. Liebert, any final comment?
Make a final comment, but move, kick the can a little bit further away from this particular question. I want to just commend the audience. What I actually enjoy most about having had the opportunity to be here is I like the fact that I know that there are going to be people in the room who feel very different on this issue, and that we're going to engage in some robust dialogue, but yet keep it so civil. This couple of hours here has really modeled what we ought to be and how we ought to be behaving as a nation. So I commend you all for that.
And I couldn't agree more. This is over 5 years now that we've been doing this, and we've been able to manage to keep it civil no matter what the topic, and we did so again. So from me, thank you also. I'm sorry we have to stop now. I do feel we could go for another hour, but I do want to respect your time. I know everybody has their own requirements. I would like to ask for a round of applause and thanks for our panel. And also the staff of the college and the institute for helping make this a success. I do hope we have added to your understanding of the First Amendment and its complexities, and that I hope that you'll leave here and go share some of the insights you learned with your friends and relatives so that, as we just heard here, that we can raise the level of civil discourse among ourselves and in a larger audience, because I think the antidote to offensive speech is more speech that puts it down in its proper place so that we can have more civil discourse. I'd like to finish by alerting you to our next program in this series, the dinner series. You see it on the screens. The End of White Christian America, Reflections on the Paradox of the 2016 Elections. The author of this book, End of White Christian America, will be here, Robert P. Jones. He wrote the book just before, it was finished just before the nominees were selected at the conventions this last summer. And he makes the case in his book that White Christian America is on the wane and no longer the force that it used to be, that it has been for the entire history of our country as a nation. But then we had the paradox of the white Christian evangelicals are responsible for putting the current the president-elect into office. So how does he reconcile that? He's going to be here to talk about it, and I hope that you will all consider coming. It'll be in this room, and I would expect a large audience for that. So please register soon. For coming, and good night. Safe journey home.